and I felt the Lord wanted me to do that, but I told them, you know, that minister is going to be preaching. He's having a conference in the Swiss Alps, and we should go and hear his heart as much as possible if we're going to launch a church for him. So I made the arrangements. We all went to the Swiss Alps, and the second night of that conference, the Lord spoke the second time, and all he said this time was, go to the mountain. I said, oh, you know how you just know that you know. I said, oh, these mountains. These mountains. And I said, yes, Lord. And so I just, I didn't tell anybody on the team because we were supposed to go to Spain and launch the church. And so I went to Spain and helped launch the church. And when we finished that assignment, I said, now I have to go back to Switzerland. And they said, well, Mary, you can't do that. First of all, you don't know one person and you don't speak the language. They don't speak English up there. They speak Swiss German and Romanish and Italian, and they don't speak any English. And they said, you don't know the language, and you don't even have the budget, because the budget in Spain is a lot less than the Swiss Alps. I mean, a small pizza is $50 up around there.
Oh,
and I said, well, it doesn't matter. If God calls you to go, then everything's covered, you know.
Amen.
So I went, and just one day and two phone calls, I had a place to stay, and I had that place for 3 years. And all I had to do was just pay. We have to pay what they call, it's called a core tax, but it's actually like an air tax. You have to pay for breathing the air up in the Alps, because if you get sick, you shouldn't get sick up there, because that's good, clean air. And if you paid the core tax, then your medical expenses would be a little deducted, because you shouldn't have gotten sick. So, and I think I paid like a little over $1 a day. And I would just, but only when I was up there. If I went down into Zurich or something, I wasn't breathing their air, so I found out all I do is just check the calendar which day I was in the mountains. And then I just take my calendar to the office, and they say, okay, 1, 2, 5, 6. Okay, you owe air for 18 days. That's it, you know. That's all my expenses, you know. But I went over there I had one partner, $15 a month. It was my cousin. She had faith in me to go. And so I lived off, you know, God just makes a way. He just makes a way. But I led so many people. I think that first week I led 9 people to the Lord just supernaturally. Because I would just go on the streets, and like I told them, I would open my apartment door and I said, okay, Lord, now we're going to go outside. So I'll be me and you be you.
Yeah.
And together we can make an explosion.
Amen.
So I just walked the streets just to meet the people, because they're not going to come to me. They don't even know I exist. So I've got to be out there walking the streets. And I'd go in one restaurant for hot chocolate, then I crossed the road for goulash soup, and then I crossed the road for apple strudel. I'm like, you know, it's expensive, Lord, eating up here, you know. I don't know anybody. But every person that I had a divine connection to lead to the Lord, they were giving me money. By the end of my month, I had enough money to fly all the way back. So, but I was telling them, I led two of the Catholic priests to the Lord. And one of them, he let me use his building. I was wanting to have a gospel concert. And I told the people, I'm going to come back, and I want to bring a friend from England that sings at Royal Albert Hall every year. And she's got an operatic voice, but she sings gospel. So we'll have a concert. And that's when 66 people showed up. But I just had somebody help me write a little flyer in German, and you just tape it on the barn doors, because it's just a small village. Just tape it wherever you could find a piece of tape. Tape it up there. And but I asked the Protestant pastor if I could use his church for the gospel concert, and he said, sure, sure. I said, may I have permission to have an evangelistic message? And he said, what kind of message is that? What's that mean, evangelistic? I said, well, I just want to tell people about the love of Jesus and tell them about heaven. And oh, I don't know if you could say something like that. You'd have to get permission from the president of the presbytery. So I contacted him, and I said, I have permission to use the building, but I need your permission to have an evangelistic message. And he said, now what does that mean? This is the president of the presbytery. I told him, I said, I want to talk about Jesus in heaven. Oh, absolutely not. You can never talk like that about Jesus in our church. So I thought, moving right along. I said, thank you anyway. So I went over to there's only two churches in the village, the Catholic church and the Protestant church. So I went to the Catholic priest. And I said, may I use your building for a concert? He said, sure. I said, may I have an evangelistic message here? And he said, and what does that mean? So I explained it to him, and he said, oh, we don't care what what to talk about, just as long as you pay the rent. I'll pay. I use the Catholic Church from a Bible school, Alpha courses, Bible studies, everything. I use the Catholic Church. And I would invite the priest to come into the Alpha courses once in a while. He'd come. And one day he came in, I was getting ready for my Bible school and getting ready to set up the chairs and tables. And he came in and we're the only ones in the room, and he whispers. He said, you're what they call charismatic, aren't you? I said, yes, I am. He said, does that mean you talk in that one kind of language? I said, yes, I do. He said, how does that work? I want to know, how does that work? Well, I want to have quality time with him. I said, now, Vicar, my Bible school students are coming in any minute, but I could come back a little bit later. And again, because I needed quality time to explain it to him. And he said, well, are you free on Thursday? I said, yes. He said, are you free at 10 o'clock? I said, yes. He opened up his day timer and he wrote down, Marilyn Neubauer, Holy Ghost, they're both coming at 10 o'clock on Thursday. And we all showed up. Hallelujah. Praise God. But you know, we are living in very exciting times. You know, yes. The Lord is coming back soon. We have.
You got to finish that story about going back down the road.
Oh, okay. I led the second Catholic priest I led to the Lord. One of my Bible school students said she's been talking to her priest about me because she would come to my meetings every week. And she said, I've been telling my priest about you. And he must know if you'd come up to our mountain range and tell him about that Holy Ghost. I said, you tell him, I'll come up and tell him about that Holy Ghost. And so I had met a gentleman in my village, actually he lived in another mountain range, but he would come down to my village, and I met him, and he always would give me his car whenever he'd be out of the country. He was a prominent businessman, and he always had a brand new BMW. And it was a nice car, but I didn't really want to drive somebody's brand new BMW on the mountain winding roads, no guardrails in the winter. You know, and of course this was a winter day, and so I drove up to my friend's house, and she, like I said, she lives in a much higher, I mean, I was high in the mountains, but now she's a much higher mountain. And we're talking mountains in the Swiss Alps.
Yeah.
And so we got to her house, and the priest was there, and it took me 3 hours to explain the new birth to him. You know, how simple can it be? And he said, I just don't like that term, new birth. And I said, Holy Spirit, give me something else quick. And the Holy Spirit said, tell him it's having new life in Christ. I said, Father Ambrosie, it's like having a whole new life in Christ. And he goes, that's exactly what I want. I need new life. Because he was 84, 87. I need new life. I said, well, this would be new life. He said, can we ask for new life? I don't want to ask for new birth. I want new life. We'll pray for new life. And so he got born again. And he said, now, how about that Holy Ghost? I said, okay. So I was explaining that to him. And, you know, sometimes people have a hard time receiving the baptism. And so he was struggling. And I said, now, Father Ambrosie, and he was a real big man and had the whole garb. He looked like a monk, you know. And I said, now, Father Ambrosie, sometimes you can receive through the laying on of hands. Now, would it be okay if I just put my hand on your shoulder? He hesitates. Well, okay. So I gently put my hand on his shoulder, and nothing was happening. So I started to take my hand away and said, no, leave it there. Leave it there. I put my hand back down. All of a sudden, he started speaking fluent. Oh. I mean, it just rolled. I mean, his eyes, he said, he didn't know what to do. Okay, you can stop. Just let me explain. So he was just so ecstatic about it. But while I was there, I noticed, I kept looking out the window, but we are having a blizzard. It is really bad weather out there. It was snowing, and you could see the wind was blowing. And I've got to drive down the mountains, no guardrails. They don't put sand on the road up in the mountain. Oh, boy. So and I had to take him back to the Abbey. So he and I, we got in the car, and he said, do you think I should pray in tongues? I said, all the way to the Abbey. That's the one, just pray all the way to the Abbey. the language up there, and so I was, when I'd go to the store, I would mainly just get vegetables and salads, you know, but one day I thought, oh, it sure would be nice to just have a nice piece of chicken, and I just need some meat, you know, and all their packages, the meat's all packaged up, and it just has the name on it, you know, in the package, and of course I couldn't read it, and so I went over to the meat section, and there was a man standing there, and so I picked up this package of meat, and I said, sir, that is, and he looked at me and he said, nine, oink, oink, oink. That's how I lived in the Swiss Alps. But it was a very, very fulfilling, rewarding time being up there, you know. But you know, it can be a lonely work, because I'm up there all alone. No computer, no telephone, no, only a German radio. There was nothing up there. And,
sounds like a blessing.
So I just, you know, just walked the streets. And I was up there every season, you know, and it's just, it was lonely, but it was just so rewarding. And your walks are just nothing but praise. I mean, you just, oh, it is just so gorgeous up there. You just can't say, well, thank you for all that you have created. It's just beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And the cows are eyeball to eyeball with you. And you share the water trough. And it's lovely. It's lovely. But it was I loved that. It was my very first assignment, and I loved that assignment. You know, so. But the Lord is coming back soon. It's going to be very exciting. So very exciting. Beyond we can even begin to imagine. But when he comes back, you know, we're called the bride of Christ. Mm-hmm. But when he comes back, he's not coming back just for the bride. He's coming back for the army of the Lord. Mm-hmm. And the army of the Lord will be wearing combat boots, not slippers. He'll be wearing combat boots. And for such a time as this, you and I cannot afford to be held back or distracted from doing kingdom business because of sickness or disease. Yes. We've got to have on those combat boots.
Come on.
You've got to have bulldog tenacity. You've got to fight the good fight of faith. And the fight of faith is the only fight we have to fight. It's the only one, just the fight of faith. But today, and tomorrow, since I'm going to be having three sessions with you, I'm going to share in my teachings all three of my miraculous miracles, my healing miracles, because I teach from them. But I thought I'm going to use all three of those in my time with you this weekend. But healing, there's no formula to healing. Mm-hmm. It's all about a relationship. Mm-hmm. It's all about a relationship. And I love what the Apostle Paul says, and I'm going to read this to you out of Philippians. I'm going to read it in the Amplified, so just listen to what he says. But here's the Apostle Paul writing to the church of Philippi, and he is, well, God used him to write over two-thirds of the New Testament, and this is what he says: my determined purpose is that I might know you.
Yes.
He's been writing two-thirds of the New Testament. He's got, I just want to know you. I just want to know you, that I may progressively, not overnight, but progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him. Intimacy, relationship, intimacy with you. He said, perceiving, recognizing, and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly, and that I may in that same way come to know the power outflowing from his resurrection. That's pretty powerful. That is his determined purpose, is to become intimately with the Lord. And then I like in Jeremiah what the Lord says, and this again is the Amplified, but it's Jeremiah 9:23. It says, let not the wise and the skillful person glory or boast, or we can say brag, in his wisdom and skill. Let not the mighty and the powerful person glory or boast or brag in his strength and power. Let not the person who is rich, physical gratification and earthly wealth, glory and boast in his temporal satisfactions and earthly riches. But let him who glories in this, If you're gonna brag about anything, the Lord says, this is the one thing that you can glorify about, that you understand and that you know me personally. Mm-hmm. And practically, directly discerning and recognizing my character, that I am, and that I practice loving kindness, judgment, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, says the Lord.
Yes.
The Lord actually has a daily workout of pouring out his loving kindness to you and to me. He absolutely delights in showing us his goodness, his love, and his kindness.
Yes.
Again, it's all about a relationship, not a formula. It's just knowing him. I remember one time this pastor was preaching and he asked if there were any children in the congregation that could recite the 23rd Psalm. And this one little girl, she raised her hand. And he called her up there and he held the mic and he says, can you tell us what the first verse is of the 23rd Psalm? And she said, yes, the Lord is my shepherd, that's all I want. Now, she misquoted that, but what a profound statement.
Yes.
Until we can say he's all I want, we'll never be able to say I shall not want. Mm-hmm. See, that's all about intimacy. I want you to remember that little story. But then the Apostle Paul goes on to say, and you should read every day Ephesians chapter 1, and perhaps you do that, but in Ephesians chapter 1, beginning in verse 16, 17 through verse 20, but it says, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation of the knowledge of him, that the eyes of your understanding would be enlightened, that you would know the hope of his calling and the riches of the glory of the inheritance of the saints. You need to pray every day for spiritual enlightenment.
Yes.
Every day.
Yeah.
But I want to re-emphasize in Ephesians 3, also from the Apostle Paul, beginning in verse 17, that he, meaning God, would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, that you would be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man. So you need that inner strength. That Christ may dwell in your heart through faith. Because faith is of the heart. That Christ would dwell in your heart through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love, that's intimacy, grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and the height, and to know to know the love of Christ that passes all human knowledge, it passes all natural understanding, that you might be filled with all the fullness of him. Now he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask, according to the power that works in us.
Mm-hmm.
According to that power, that inner strength, that intimacy of love, according to that, you know, the more you comprehend his love for you, the easier it is to walk by faith.
Yeah.
If you know that you know that you know he loves you,
mm-hmm.
it is so much easier to walk by faith because you know he's with you.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing more greater than having that intimacy with the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, we were created to fellowship with him. And it is so critical that we truly understand that we are loved by Father God. We are loved by the Father. And that nothing we have ever done or ever will do can separate us from that love. There's nothing that you could ever do that can separate you from that love. Love put Jesus on the cross, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And love kept Jesus on the cross.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one of my students in Switzerland, she said, I heard that verse, God so loved the world, and I know God loves me. And she said, does Jesus also love me? I thought, what an innocent question. I thought, oh yes, love kept him on the cross for you.
Mm-hmm.
She said, does Jesus love me too? Just an innocent question. question from someone who hardly knew anything about the Lord. But love, that's the most important thing, is intimacy. And I think it's so important that we understand that not only nothing can separate you from the love of Christ, but because of that, you are always worthy to receive healing. I've talked to so many people, and many people, what they think in their heart, they don't say. They'll say all the right scriptures, do all the right things, but there's just something there that says, but I don't really think I'm worthy. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people don't say what really is in the depth of their heart. Mm-hmm. And there's probably a lot of us here today that there's something there, you know, that maybe we've never expressed or said to anybody, but we need to know that we are worthy. And I want to give an example. I'm going to ask a couple ladies to come up here to help me. Just hold something for me. There's two ladies going to jump right up here. There you go.
I'd go, but I got a beard, yeah.
You got one?
A beard.
I would go, but I'm not qualified.
I'll call you up a little bit later. How's that? We're going to get the men involved.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to put this around you back here. And that represents the purity of Jesus.
No.
All things are subject to change. Of course, this represents the sins of the world. Now, if you all may have Bibles with you, open your Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. It says, 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he, that's talking about God, made him, talking about Jesus, for God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become, or we could say be made, the righteousness of God in him. Mm-hmm. Now I want us to look at that word made. God made Jesus to be sin. The word made means to be changed. To be changed so as to qualify to serve a specific purpose. Jesus had to be changed. He had to be made sin in order to pay the penalty of sin. Mm-hmm. In other words, at this point, Jesus, he knew no sin. He had to be made sin. He had to be made guilty so that he would pay the penalty of sin. So Jesus was made guilty. Excuse me. All the sins of the human race, every sickness, every disease was placed upon Jesus. It says that even at the cross he was so marred you couldn't even recognize him. The sins of the entire human race are now placed upon Jesus. Every sickness, every disease. He was now guilty of sin. He was made sin. It's the same way in the law. If you were found guilty of a crime, the judge says, well, the jury has pronounced you guilty. We just want to know if you were guilty or not, but now we know, but you're welcome to go home. No. If you are found guilty, you now pay the penalty. You have to be not guilty to get to go home.
Right.
If you're guilty, you must now pay the penalty of that crime. It says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, eternal separation. But God loved us so much that he did not want us to be separated from him throughout all eternity. So in exchange, he made Jesus to be the guilty party. And again, to be made, it says that we became the righteousness of God. So then we were changed so as to qualify to serve a specific purpose. That purpose was that now we have been changed and we are now not guilty. Not guilty. We are not guilty. We have been changed so that we could serve a specific purpose. And the purpose of being not guilty, Adam walked with God in the garden. We walk with God in righteousness. It's so shame, guilt, sin, no condemnation. It's as though it never happened. Whatever you did in your past, even if it was just yesterday, if you've repented, you are not guilty. And now, after Jesus paid the penalty, he went to the cross, died, went to the pit of hell, he rose again from the dead, and he is now seated at the right hand of the Father. Makes me want to cry. When God looks at Jesus, and he looks at you and me, equal. Equal. We are not guilty. No shame, no guilt. He bore the sins of the entire human race. And now, pure. And you and I, we have been traded. We are not guilty. Is that beautiful?
Yes.
And that is how you have to see yourself, that you thank you, lady, that you are worthy.